soon. Listen to Third Eagle's tune. Doom and gloom. God is telling us the end is coming soon. Very soon. You'll see signs up in the sun and stars and moon. Doom and gloom. Very soon. Rapture comes at night or noon. Doom and gloom. Very soon. If you're ready, you will meet the bride and groom. Don't be dumb, rapture comes. Don't be dumb, rapture comes. Trim your wick or face the gun. Don't be dumb, rapture comes. Fill your lamps, there won't be oil for everyone. 7 years, tears and fears. Jesus said that it will be the very worst. 7 years, tears and fears. Britain, Russia, and the U.S. will be toast. World War III, don't blame me. World War III.
Hey, happy Friday. Welcome to Audiotopsy. This episode is brought to you by Jiffy Pop Popcorn. Kenny put me up for that. I thought it was funny. But hey, guys, we got a deep cut for you tonight. We got a good song here and hope you all enjoy it. Here's just our little kind of disclaimer. We're a few months into the show. A lot of y'all are saying, what are you guys doing? Hey, we don't know what we're doing either. So we're all in this together. We're figuring it out. But basically, the gist of what we're doing here, we're not endorsing these artists or these bands. What we're doing is we're recognizing the power of music and the power of words and the combination of the two together, lyrics and a powerful message with a powerful beat. It has the power to transform the mind and the soul. And so we have to be intentional about the music we listen to. We have to just be in full beta wave mode when we listen to music and interact with the lyrics. So that's what we're hoping to do here is start conversations where we learn how to interact with our music and teach our kids how to interact with the music they're listening to. So we hope you enjoy. And if you ever have a request or a song suggestion, put it in the comments and we'll see what we can do.
Trim your wick or face the gun. Hey, if you guys notice a little bit of ambient background noise, it's raining wherever Vic is out in Missouri. So please bear with us as she's dealing with the weather. It sounds like any other time it would be relaxing, but I realize it could be a little bit distracting. Guys, this is a song that the song we're covering today is one that I really like. Of course, it has Johnny Cash involved, and anything with Johnny Cash, I'm excited to talk about. I think this is kind of interesting. The song was written by the band U2, but it was written specifically for Johnny Cash. Kenny, had you ever heard this song before? Kenny, we got no sound. Kenny's on mute. Hold on a second, folks. There we go.
Got me?
Yep.
There we go. Okay. I was like, hey, man, I thought we were doing The Wanderer by Dion. I'm really lost. Now, I will say this. I actually didn't know this song. So when Vicky put it up, I listened to it. And it's a really, musically, it's very sparse, man. There's not a whole lot going on in that. It's very, the lyrics really stand out when you listen to this. So. Lyrically, it's very rich, but yeah, I've never heard that song.
I think that has a lot to do with what this band was doing at the time musically, which was not a lot. But at least they had the good sense to invite Johnny Cash to be on this album and this song. And it's an interesting take because, of course, Johnny Cash is original country rock and roll rockabilly. And they took his voice, okay, his iconic voice, and put it over this synthesizer modern music from the mid-90s. And I think it's pretty cool. So anyway, Vic, why did you – I don't know. Yeah, I can't remember. How did we pick – why did you pick this song?
So I was never a U2 fan in the 80s because I was kind of into the metal scene. And I remember my brother and I contemplating whether or not we should go to the Joshua Tree tour. And they were coming for two nights. And we ended up not going. And the next day we went to a huge school. Hundreds of kids had the Joshua Tree tour shirts on. And my brother and I kind of looked at each other and thought, we might have missed the boat on this one, man. So I'm a little bummed I missed out on that tour. But I got really into U2 in the early 90s. One of my first mission trips was to Northern Ireland and Ireland. And so I just got into like everything U2, anything Irish. And so I think I also too, Tom, I fell into the idea, as many Christians did. We in the Christian culture, whenever we hear that somebody's a Christian or a Christian band, no holds barred, without question, without looking into it, without doing research, we're just like, it's a Christian band, he's a Christian. And so a lot of Christians back in the 80s and 90s listened to U2 thinking these are one of ours. And there were lyrics on early albums, like 40 is actually Psalm 40. I don't know if people know that, but it's just the lyric, it's Psalm 40 put to music. And so if you go into old lore and old biographies, Bono and The Edge especially talk about this youth group that they went to in Dublin, and their youth pastor has done a lot of public interviews talking about how they prayed to receive Christ. And a lot has changed on the landscape. I think, you know, I'm not the same person I was 40 years ago, so I can't expect Bono and Edge to be as well. They've been through a lot, and fame and politics and whatnot. So I have not listened to U2 for decades. But I had the Zooropa album back in the 90s, and I saw them in concert in Minneapolis, and it was actually the best seats I've ever had to a concert. I had eighth row main floor, and so it was pretty exciting. But I wasn't a huge fan of the Zooropa album. I'm not into pop. It's not really my thing, but I loved this song because I thought there was a little bit of a message to it. And if you listen to Zooropa as a whole, there's just a lot of bizarre songs on that album. The lyrics are kind of nonsensical. They don't really, you know, say anything too in depth. So I kind of felt like this was sort of like the meat of the album. At least it was attempting to make a message. So long-winded way of saying that at one time, I really loved this band. I especially love their really early stuff, like even stuff before Joshua Tree. That's kind of when I think of U2, like Unforgettable Fire and War. Those are more of the CDs I would probably pick to listen to if I still had any of their stuff in my playlist.
Yeah, no doubt. I have a very similar experience. I remember 87, U2 coming on the radio. Didn't think a whole lot about it. And then I kind of got into them in later years. And I actually really got into them when the album All That You Can't Leave Behind came out. And then I went backwards. So I've seen them several times in concert. You know, it's kind of interesting. Everything that you said about U2, I agree with. And I know the story about the youth group. And when you read about those days, there was a lot of sincerity. Okay. You know, there are maybe people listening that'll say, no, from the beginning, these guys were bad. I don't believe that personally. I believe just like a lot of people, they get in there, they get surrounded by the wrong, you know, element. Sometimes the element can be very obviously dark, okay? Because Bono was more of an activist, he got surrounded by a very dark political element. And he, I believe, sincerely wanted to do something about the AIDS epidemic in Africa. I really believe that came from a sincere place, but he made deals with the devil in order to do that. And he's even come out recently and said that, you know what? I hate to admit this, but capitalism is better. Okay. So which is kind of interesting. Very much a globalist, and I saw this years ago before I even understood what globalism was. It's, you know, I'll tell you my story with U2, and we're going to listen to this song in a little here. Why don't we jump into the song first? Okay, because this is not only about you two, it's about Johnny Cash. So let's listen to it. I don't know if anybody is, you know, is familiar with this song. People might be familiar with you two and familiar with Johnny Cash. Many people probably don't know they did a song together. And they, you know, Bono was a big admirer of Johnny Cash. Okay. And he has stories about being at his house and the prayer that Johnny Cash did and, you know, for dinner and things like this. So kind of interesting, but yeah, we're not, you know, we're not trying to make Bono into any kind of a hero. He's basically signed on the dotted line. Very unfortunate. Doesn't mean he can't be redeemed. I say we say prayers for all these people that we talk about. There's nobody beyond the reach of God. So I don't know, but let's check this out. This is The Wanderer by U2 and Johnny Cash. Johnny Cash does the vocals. It was written by Bono for Johnny Cash. Let's check it out.
Paved with gold, lifted some stones, saw the skin and bones of a city without a soul. I went out walking under an atomic sky, where the ground won't turn and the rain it burns like the tears when I said goodbye. Yeah, I went with nothing, nothing but the thought of you. I went wandering.
Vic.
So as I'm listening to this, I'm thinking, this is kind of the same theme as I still haven't found what I'm looking for. There is, you know, as Christians, as believers, if we were going to write song lyrics, I don't think any of the three of us would write song lyrics about our spiritual confusion or how we're wandering or how we're lost. And there does seem to be kind of this theme in Bono's song lyrics about he's still striving to find something that he hasn't found yet. Even where the streets have no name, I think that that's kind of political. It has to do with like Northern Ireland and Ireland not getting along. And what I know people used to say, well, heaven is where the streets have no name. But in other words, where the streets have no name, like at some point we're going to find harmony and there's not going to be streets where the rich live. And then on the other side of the tracks, it's the other people and there's gangs and war and all that. So it saddens me to see even in their earlier work that goes back to the 80s and 90s, as someone at this point who has professed Christ, there is an element of emptiness in his lyrics that, mm-hmm. you know, he's out there on a stage with the truth of the gospel in his heart, and yet he can't convey anything solid to the fandom that, hey man, I still haven't found what I'm looking for either. And when we delve deeper into these lyrics, this song is based upon the preacher in the book of Ecclesiastes. And Solomon concludes in the book of Ecclesiastes that because everything in earth is futile and meaningless, the only thing a man can really do is just dive into his work and just be dedicated to his job. And Bono thought that that was a great message because, hey, I'm a rock star and I love the work I do. And I have stumbled upon what the wisest man in the world said is the most important thing, my work, which I think maybe he's missing the point there of the theme of absolute futility. If you don't see that what we're doing here has an eternal parallel, if you don't see that to live as Christ, to die as gain, if what we're doing here has some sort of impact for an eternity, but the only thing that we can find solace or joy in is our job or our work, it's missing the point. I mean, I think that the conclusion of the preacher in Ecclesiastes is a very sad one. He was handed all the wisdom of the world. There's no one wiser who will ever exist. And life became so disenchanting to this preacher that all he could do was just get up every day and enjoy his work. And so this is kind of what I mean, like what we're doing here with Audiotopsy. We're trying to explain to people, let's look deeper into these people whose albums we have. On one hand, we have a band where half the members profess to know Christ, but then we've got a bunch of song lyrics where they seem to have not found what they're looking for, and they're wandering around lost.
No, Vic, I agree 100%. I think you'd kind of described it really good. Those two songs are very similar. And we have to look at the politics and the turmoil in Ireland and what was going on there. You know, what was happening in Ireland in the 60s, 70s, and 80s was such a big deal that, candidates and politicians in America would talk about whose side that they took, okay? The IRA, the Independent Republican Army, right? Or the Irish Republican Army, or the state. I've been to Northern Ireland as well on a mission trip, and they love it when Americans or somebody from, you know, Christians from somewhere else go there, because things are so volatile over there that it's difficult for evangelicals to minister to Catholics. And that's the reason that we went over there. So Bono grew up right in the middle of that. Of course, he was from Dublin, but he saw things were a lot more hostile, you know, back in the 70s and 80s. There were bombings and there were, you know, all kinds of stuff just going on, and they would bomb stuff. If you look at the live version of Sunday Bloody Sunday from Rattle and Hum, you'll see him talk about that. So it's unfortunate that he didn't get a good discipleship. You know what I'm saying? And just really a foundation to lead him in the right direction and give him a better standing to be a better voice, or, you know, not only for Ireland, but for the world. So, Kenny, I mean, what's your thoughts?
You know, I really, as far as like, I have no real background with U2. There wasn't a band that I really spent a lot of time listening to. I had a friend in college who was really obsessed with them, and he tried to get me on that train, and it wasn't my thing. I mean, I always appreciated what they did, but it never was something that was like, I thought they had some couple great songs and some decent little songs, but I really like this song though. Because I'm listening to it, like I said, I really like this how sparse it is in terms of even the music. Like, I can hear certain changes. This is a very generic, straightforward song, and it's basically like a basic blues. It's got a 1/4, but you don't hear the change really. You hear it in his voice inflection. There's this pad of just almost like it's just holding the sound there. And there's a little bit of bass, but his voice is doing the changes on it. And what's really amazing to it is that it sounds like someone wandering. Like, there's just this little thing there, and the little inflections of his voice imply that. So when I'm listening to it, I get a lot from it, because I feel like the lyrics are really, you know, is he saying something important? There's a lot. You can play with this song a lot when I read through it, because there's a lot of you know, yeah, I went with nothing but the thought of you, and I went wandering. And at that point, then you're speculating, well, who is you? Who is you? Who is you to him when he's talking about that? And it gets more as the song goes on, as far as like the lyrical type stuff. But I think it's really interesting that, you know, he starts right off with the imagery of I went out walking through streets paved with gold. He's right at this heaven imagery, yet he's still looking. So you're like, well, he's not there, but he's looking for it still. So I just think it's really interesting. He starts off with this really strong imagery of heaven, yet he's staying. He's not sure. He's still wandering. That's a really interesting way to start that song off.
Yeah. You know, it's really fascinating. And I think a lot of people can identify with this song. I think the more I examine the lyrics, I probably like it less. When I pay attention because of the feel. Now, this was a song that I would listen to maybe sometimes you would find a song and you would listen to it over and over for days, you know, just like wherever you're at, like, oh, I want to hear that song again, you know. Mm-hmm. And I can identify with that, especially some of the other lyrics that are coming up.
Yeah.
But yeah, so let's take a listen. Guys, we want to know what you think. We understand there's a lot of hate out there for U2. It's one of those bands, like, you either you know, love them or hate them, you know, and there's a lot of hate. Yeah. So I don't know if there's middle ground. I'm sure it's very little in the middle. So
yeah. I'm in the middle.
Yeah, let's take a look. Let's take another look at this song.
I went drifting through the capitals of tin, where men can't walk or freely talk, and sons turn their fathers in. I stopped outside a church house where the citizens like to sit. They say they want the kingdom, but they don't want God in it.
That's powerful.
So, well, yeah, there's some interesting things there, you know, talking about, fathers turning their son, our sons turning their fathers in. Okay, we recognize this not only from the Bible, but here we are, we're living these times, you know. What's being said here is kind of prophetic. Mm-hmm. And I took the lyric, sitting outside the church house was saying that they wanted the kingdom, but it was the people's rejection and even Christians' rejection of God. I don't know. I could be wrong about that. That's my take. What do you think, Vic?
Yeah. So, man, that's just such a powerful line. I'm still getting my head wrapped around it. You know, it's interesting, you know, on some of the other shows that we do, Tom, when we're talking about more doctrine and things like that, you know, Michael Lake coined this phrase that we're never going to understand what the Bible is really saying if we are divorced from the culture, the context, the history, the geography, and the language. And I really feel it's sort of the same with these song lyrics. We are hearing this song through the eyes of
Americans,
mm-hmm. Evangelical Americans, white mm-hmm. people. We're in this country, and we're in a little bit of a different age bracket than Bono as well. We're a little bit younger than him. And interestingly, he's in this tiny country that's, you know, in the midst of an ongoing civil war. And it's not just political factions. It's Roman Catholic against Protestant. And he actually was raised in a home. I can't remember which parent was which, but he was in a home where one parent was raised Catholic and one was raised Protestant. Wow. And so he had this perspective probably on what was going on in the country. I'm wondering if this is where some of his altruistic, we can save the world, love is all we need kind of comes from, because he saw it for a time. I think his mother died when he was young, but he saw it playing out in his own home, that these two opposing forces that was destroying his whole country really could get along mm-hmm. if there was love there. So I do understand where a lot of the kind of more altruistic ideas of, like, we can fix the world come from. And what's interesting to me about Bono's lyrics and his political involvement is, I think that he really does, at least in his youth, I think he really did, between believing in God and the power of God and believing in these organizations that he was involved in, I think he probably really did feel like he could change the world. You know, you're on stage every night, people are screaming and cheering, you have influence, people listen to every word you say. And yeah. I think that he really did think that there could be change. And so that's why that line is so powerful to me. They say they want the kingdom, but they don't want God in it. Because as a professing believer in his youth, he probably was meeting with church influencers. And Tom, you showed a video once where he was in a room with all of the Christian artists, that he had the ear of the Christian artists. And at that point, instead of let's change the world for the gospel, it now became, let's just change the world for the sake of the world and the people in it, for the betterment of. So at some point there, they say they want the kingdom, but they don't want God in it. I think that was sort of a foreshadowing of what was even to come in his own life, because back in the early 90s, I think he was probably still trying to walk that line. And at this point, he is giving his life's work that he thinks, hey, Solomon said, your work is the most important thing. His life work now is not preaching the gospel. It is making the world a better place to live.
You know, I think it's interesting that we're talking about Bono from U2, but Johnny Cash is singing this song. Obviously, you know, he's covered a lot of songs. He even covered the song One by U2 at one point. And does a very haunting version of it. I think it's kind of interesting. The band Coldplay actually wrote a song for Johnny Cash, but Johnny Cash passed away before he got a chance to sing it. And man, it would be neat to hear him sing this song. It's called Kingdom Come. And I mean, Johnny Cash covered a lot of songs, and he... You know, I guess in some way, you know, endorse this. I mean, I don't think there's anything crazy, you know, theologically or, you know, politically in this song. So, yeah, I don't know. Anyway, let's listen to some more and talk about some more. Kenny, yeah, I'm sorry. You got your turn. Sorry.
I was going to say that I think the reason that Johnny Cash was used for the singing here is that I don't care what Johnny Cash sang, you believed him when he sang it. When he said, I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die, you believe that. But then you also hear him sing songs that have more religious connotation and his God stuff, and you feel that too. And I think that that's such a believable thing in his voice, is because people have seen Johnny Cash and his whole thing. He was still the man in black, but yeah. His vocals, like I said, even on this, he's singing very little, you know, inflection to change it. It's very small. There's not a lot of melodic stuff going on, but yet it's still very moving by the way he just changes one little note and he sings that line, and you're just like, it just resonates with you. So, and I think it's really smart for you too, because they realize that if Bono had sang this song, it wouldn't have anywhere what it has for this. Now it's a very memorable song, but because Johnny sang it.
Yeah. So this is, yeah, Johnny Cash with U2. Johnny Cash also, this is kind of interesting, not as well known, but he did a song. He did a cover of his own song, Man in Black, with a punk band, a Christian punk band that I used to listen to, called One Bad Pig. Matter of fact, they're going to be at this festival, you know, that I'm probably going to go to here in Ohio next year. But that was, Johnny Cash was very open-minded when it came to doing music. Yeah, look up the song Man in Black by One Bad Pig. You'll hear them. Like, I think they got a message to him, said, hey, we want to cover this song. And the management said, why don't you have Johnny Cash do the song with you? So Johnny Cash on a punk song, a punk version. That's amazing. A Man in Black.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So, great. Yeah. Anyway, Kenny, I saw the movie last week. It was in theaters for a few days. It was called Johnny Cash, The Redemption of American Icon.
Oh, wow.
And wow, that was a really good movie. It was a documentary about just Johnny's Christian journey and how, you know, when he was a little kid, his family, you know, was very spiritual. His older brother who died when he was 15 was going to be a preacher. He would study the word and stuff, and just all the things that happened in Johnny Cash's life. He wanted to sing gospel songs, but they're like, you can't sing this. Everybody sings this. We want something different. So he started singing different songs. The lifestyle of celebrity and rock stardom caught up with him. And, you know, the drugs just took him on a ride he didn't want to go. It was such a powerful movie. The very opening scene, I got emotional because I was like, oh, wow, this is where they're going to go. And it shows the cave, the very cave that Johnny Cash crawled into to die. Okay.
Oh.
And he was going to commit suicide. Here's a guy who had sold, you know, millions of records, and he just thought his life was worthless. And he crawled back there. His flashlight died all the way in the darkness to die. And basically God got him up and took him out of that cave, and he was able to get out of there. But when Johnny Cash got his life straightened out, he began proclaiming Christianity from the stage. And his record label was like, well, hey, cut that out. We don't want you doing that. We want you to have this outlaw, you know, persona. And he began doing it on his TV show and, you know, other places. He got very involved. And something I found out about Johnny Cash I didn't know before was he became an ordained minister. I didn't know this. Yeah. Hmm. So, but when, you know, and again, just more of a story, this wasn't really covered in the movie, but he, in the 80s, he had some pain because he got attacked by an ostrich on his farm. But he refused to take the painkillers because he was so afraid of getting addicted to the painkillers again. So, but because that had been something that had gripped his life. You know what I'm saying?
Sure. And hey, but you know what?
The movie was so good. Let me say this. At the end of the movie, they had like a bonus part where the producer came on and he said, hey, just in case you don't understand this, this is what it means to be saved. This is how you can get saved. And he explained, you know, how to pray. He even said a prayer. And he said, if you pray this prayer and mean it, you know, he's like, I want you to understand what salvation is and how to get saved. And,
that's amazing.
You know, basically, if God can save Johnny, he can save you anyway. Kenny.
Yeah. No, I was just going to say, I mean, when you really, really think about it, what's more outlaw than professing Jesus Christ as your Lord, man? That is, dude, you're fighting the world at that point. And to me, and hearing that with about Johnny Cash, really, it solidifies his heart, man. He really, I think he wanted to make sure it was there. He didn't care what, that was what I said. It's more outlaw. He was like, whatever, I'm going to profess it. I'm going to talk about it, put it out there. And that to me is, it's amazing. That's cool. I got to see this movie. I didn't know anything about it.
Kenny, I was thinking the same exact thing as you as soon as Tom said it, and we're seeing it play out so perfectly in today's culture.
Absolutely.
The Christians really are the ones that are outside of the law. We're the ones saying, like, no, that's immoral. That's biblically not where we want to go. So I know it's contrary because everybody wants to think of like a gunslinger with a trench coat and a cowboy hat and, you know, a six shooter, but the true outlaws are the people that stand up. The Shadrach, the Meshach, the Abednego is like, I'm not bowing down to your big tower, and I don't care if you throw me into your furnace. Like, the true outlaws are the believers in Christ.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, last week we talked about Waylon Jennings and Willie Nelson a little bit, and their kind of very mixed up idea. You know, they're very basically belief in God on their own terms. You know, Johnny Cash has made it clear over and over again that he is a Christian, you know, and that's where he stands. And he was very vocal about his witness to the people that he ran into, you know. So, we're talking about Johnny Cash, another story about Johnny Cash was one time they were waiting on him in the studio. They couldn't figure out what was going on. And this was a comment from Tom Petty. And they were like, well, when he got there, it's like, well, what took you so long? He's like, oh, well, we ran into a guy at the bus stop and we wanted to talk to him. And Tom Petty is just like shaking his head. He's like, wow, this guy is friends with presidents and guys at the bus stop, you know?
Yeah.
So that was the kind of guy he was. And he just, you know, he wasn't like a celebrity that was, you know, untouchable, you know, and unapproachable, but very kind of down to earth. When we used to go on trips, what we call shatter trips or reap trips, and I got a chance to be the DJ, I was always playing Johnny Cash songs, and they would make fun of me because I just listened to Johnny Cash a lot. But I did turn on Russ Dizdar to a few Johnny Cash songs, especially the song I Won't Back Down. But anyway, let's listen to some more of this song, The Wanderer, by U2 and Johnny Cash. So
I went out riding down that old eight lane. I passed by a thousand signs looking for my own name. I went with nothing but the thought you'd be there too, looking for me.
What does that mean? He passed a thousand signs looking for his own name. He kind of admits he's looking for a sign from God, or he's looking for communication from God. Like, what do you want me to do? I'm out here wandering. And it's kind of sad that so much time is being wasted. The information that we need is all in God's word. You know, I think this is a real thing. And this reflects the lives of a lot of people. I've definitely been in those seasons. It's like, okay, what do you want me to do, God? And you don't get anything done. So, Vic.
Tom, I swear we've been hanging out too much because we're like reading each other's thoughts. Like, that was the line that popped out at me. And I was thinking about how in the younger generations, like our generation and younger, the Bible is no longer this revelation of the redemptive plan of, you know, the fulfillment of Genesis 3:15, where the seed is going to come and crush the serpent. And all of scripture is the unfolding and the explanation of this redemptive story. It's the story that's written in the stars. It's the story in the Masoreth. It's the story in the word. But we have turned the Bible, these younger generations, we've turned the Bible into our personal daily horoscope, and we're looking in scripture for our own name. How does this apply to me? And again, going back to Michael Lake's comment, context, culture, language, history. Like, if we're not reading the Bible to find out what it's actually saying, we're in there every day in the midst of our depression, our sadness, our confusion, decisions we need to make about life. And we're looking for some sort of horoscope. Like, what is this verse saying to me? When some verses, it's not talking about you. It is talking very specifically about a promise to Israel or a promise to Judah or something that Jesus is going to fulfill in his lifetime. And so I think that when we lose sight of the fact that the Bible isn't our daily like horoscope, that it actually is telling a story outside of us, and we can be enveloped in the story. We can become a part of it. But I believe that there's a lot of people that aren't reading the Bible because they want to know God more, or they want to pursue holiness, or they truly want to see the face of God. They long to see him. They're looking for their daily fortune cookie reading.
You know, when you look at something like a more recent example of somebody like Kanye West, right? Here's a guy who was on an interview, very controversial interview a couple weeks ago. And every chance he got, he kept saying, Jesus is the way. Jesus is the way. We need Jesus. Jesus is the way, you know? And I know there's a lot of people out there that are like, well, he's this, he's a plant, he's an imposter, whatever. I don't know. I think he's very mixed up. And it would be great if he could get discipled. It's, you know, I can't really disagree with any of the lyrics on his album that came out a couple years ago. What was it called? The Blue Album. Anyway, yeah, I mean, it was all, you know, pretty much gospel songs. I should be careful. There's probably a couple of things I disagree, but for the most part,
I'm going to add in, like, what Vicky's talking about. And I think is the biggest problem people have with reading the Bible is that, like you said, people are picking it apart into small little bits and chunks of wisdom or knowledge. And they forget that the Bible wasn't originally written that way. Everything wasn't divided out. I mean, stories were stories. You will get a whole lot out of reading stuff in perspective of having, you know, like in part of my daily reading, like I had John 2 yesterday. It's a small thing, but reading that in context by itself helps you understand the context it was written and who it was for. You know, you have to do more than just, and then you're just like, oh, my daily reading today is this. And you read that, and then you're reading out of context. That's why I see so many people that they have a lot of scripture that they put up that they think is really about them as a person, and it's not. And you're like, I see where you're utilizing it, but this is really meant, was written toward Israel and stuff like that. And you, and I get what that is. And people are like, yeah, but you know, God knows the plans he has for me. And I'm like, yeah, but that phrase and that little bit of scripture is not what he's talking about. But you have, but I think that's the biggest problem, is that people have gotten into this thing. It's very, we're in a very, you know, bites of stuff, little tiny tidbits. We're not getting the big picture anymore. And I think that's the hardest part, is that if you don't understand the Bible from Genesis to Revelation as a complete story of, you know, of Jesus being in the whole entire Bible. You know, I had somebody try to come at me because of I got a Striper Bible this week, and I was real excited about it, man. It was really cool. And I've wanted one for 35 years, and you know, it's just the New Testament and Proverbs and Psalms, and it's really cool. But I was really amazed at what it had in it. And my feeling when I was reading some of the stuff at the beginning, it laid out the entire story. They didn't have the whole Bible, but it laid it out as in, this is the entire story from Genesis to Revelation. This is the story of Jesus. This is what goes into it. And I was like, this is amazing. Because if I didn't know Christ and I got this and read it, I would be interested. I'd be like, this is amazing. But I had somebody that was trying to come at me and said, oh, look, it's just the New Testament. Why is their name using, you know, Isaiah 53:5? Are they saying that because it's in the Old Testament? And I was like, I'm not sure what you're going for here, but yeah, their name was from that. But it was like, they're like, why aren't they throwing out the whole Bible? And I'm like, well, honestly, I'm going to tell you this. I don't think if they throw out whole Bibles, people are going to get hit and get hurt. They don't need the whole Bible. It's a tiny part. It's called giving you a little bit of that word, and you go, oh, okay, I get it. And then you get the big picture. But they were really trying to come at me with that. And I was like, you're seeing this entirely wrong. This is not what this is.
All right. I don't think I want to get hit by a full-on Old and New Testament. That would hurt.
Yeah. Not even leather-bound, like hardback.
And I think so, too. And kind of tying into what we were talking about on, you know, is if we as Americans listen to song lyrics written by someone from another country, we are going to really miss things that they're conveying in their worldview. And it's the same thing with Scripture. It ties into what we're talking about now. I think the American culture, through the centuries, we really think of ourselves as an individual. And yeah, we have families and we love our families. And we might think, you know, in a Christian context, well, I got married, so me and my spouse are one. We might have like little moments there where we're willing to let another person into our little inner circle. But I mean, even just like our military, I think the Army had a slogan once, Army of One. So instead of it being like all these soldiers as a unit or as a team, now it's like, you know, look at me. And so I was reading recently in just a random YouTube video, and there was a man who left a comment, and he was from Japan. And thank you, random man from Japan, because it was an eye-opening comment for me. He said, it's so weird to me as a Japanese man to hear Americans talk, and everything is me, my house, my car. And he's like, over here, it's always our and us. Like, we think in terms of our whole family or our neighborhood or our, you know, our culture. And so when we as Americans take this army of one mentality into our daily devotions, and all of a sudden Israel disappears, Judah disappears, the assembly of believers disappears, the Christian church disappears, and it's all just, what is God speaking to me today? And it's not that God's not a personal God and that he doesn't lead and direct us, but I really think that we are culturally at a massive disadvantage when we think that the Bible is just our personal little roadmaps, divorced from the entire body that we're a part of.
Mm-hmm. Kenny, yeah. Speaking of Striper and the Striper Bibles, when I saw them earlier this year, they mentioned that they would throw Bibles out, but people wouldn't take them with them. So they started putting their logo on there, and people would take them with them. Think about how many seeds have been planted by those Bibles that somebody got, from their show and took home. They just recently played in Mexico with a bunch of, secular bands. One of them, King Diamond. And Michael Sweet got a lot of flack for doing a photo op with King Diamond. There you go. King Diamond, if anybody doesn't know, he's made no bones about it. He is a Satanist. Yeah. And Michael Sweet here, you know, they took this picture together. I think this is an amazing picture. And this picture reminds me of something, you know, that Johnny Cash would do. This picture, you know, reminds me of something that any of us on Through the Black would do. We talk about this. We're okay with meeting Satanists. We want to meet Satanists. We want to engage them and talk to them. You know, what would be the right thing to do? I don't want to go there. That's where all the Satanists are, all the pagans are. You know, why did you go play at that place? What? That's insane to me. What? You know, could you imagine if Michael Seaton, no, I don't want my picture taken with King Diamond. This is insane. I'm like, I can't even believe. There's a couple times where I saw people talking about this and I typed out a thing and I was like, nah, I'm not even going to say anything. I don't want it at all. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, I agree.
Hey, you guys, wouldn't it be cool if, like, Jesus came in the 21st century instead of the first century? And, like, what if Jesus had an Instagram? I mean, honestly, I mean, all throughout his day and through his ministry, like, who would he be taking pictures with? I mean, in his day, he hung around with tax collectors, lepers, prostitutes. Like, he hung out with, he got flack for hanging out with the riffraff. I mean, can you just imagine the people that he would be taking selfies with on social media? We would be... Every one of those like stereotypical Christian women would be on there going, I can't believe you.
That's it. That's the truth right there.
No kidding. You know, and again, Johnny Cash, he got a lot of flack for, you know, going into the prisons and playing concerts. And they're like, don't do it. He's like, I'm going to do it. He's like, I don't care. He began getting so many letters from people in prison. He wanted to go and minister to them. So, and it's just, it's what we're supposed to do. It's the gospel.
Yeah.
It's the gospel. I agree. So let's listen to some more of this song. This is The Wanderer by U2 and Johnny Cash. Johnny Cash doing the vocals.
I went out there in search of experience. And to touch and to feel as much as a man can before he repents.
Okay, that's the line there that I'm like, that's real. That I mean, it's not right. You know what I'm saying? And I don't recommend it, but that's life. That's what people do. And I've definitely been down that road. I want to indulge. I want to touch the fire, so to speak, before I repent, or you know what I'm saying? And I was just watching a video before I came down to do this show, and it was a guy on there. He said, folks, he's like, don't give up praying for your sons and daughters. He said, my dad prayed for me for 30 years, and I got saved. He said, I went into my dad's prayer closet and told him to quit praying for me, you know? And he said, I'm saved. And he said, I got to call my dad up. And I said, Dad, guess what? He said, you got saved. And he said, yes. You know, his dad believed he was going to get saved. So anyway, that's life. That's real. I don't necessarily think it's endorsing that life, you know, going out in indulgence and saying, you know, this is what I did. You know, I went to commit as much sin as I could before I asked for forgiveness. Vic?
You know what is so sort of giving me cognitive dissonance about this song is we know a little bit about the lives and the backgrounds and the spiritual beliefs of both Johnny Cash and Bono. And it is so weird. I think without realizing it, when we listen to music, we attribute everything that the singer is singing with the singer. And like, I know I was blown away after I was obsessed with Petra in eighth grade. And I didn't realize until I got much older that Bob Hartman, the guitar player, was actually the one that wrote most of the lyrics. And as a kid, I just assumed that everything that was being sung was something that the lead singer had written. And it was about his life. And it was almost like I had this, identity crisis where like, oh, wait a minute. I thought that that was Greg X Volz's heart being poured out. And it's really the guitar players. And so when you listen to this song and you know that, you know, Johnny Cash is a professing believer, but you know, he came out of, you know, this rock and roll lifestyle, you hear him singing this and you're like, this is coming out of the heart of Johnny Cash. And maybe he can resonate with it, but it's like Bono wrote it. Like, you have to do this extra hurdle in your mind. Like, this is actually the worldview of Bono coming out on the page. And as a writer, as a poet, you know, which is kind of the same thing as a lyricist, I feel this. It's almost like a strange form of plagiarism when someone else is reading or singing something that you've written. I remember once I had, my very first book was a poem book I wrote with my mom. We rewrote all the Psalms, 150 Psalms, using 150 different styles of poetry. And so I worked on this book for over a year, edited it for a year. It was like, you know, so you read these poems a million times because you're editing them and you're trying to tweak everything. And I was at a poetry reading where a man had my book and he was reading my poems and he was butchering them. Like, every single word on the page he was reading, but just the way he was reading it, in my mind, it lost all of the emotion and all of the hurt and everything that was put into that poem. And it was just really a learning moment for me that what we write, whether it's in a journal, it's in an email, it's a text to a friend, everything that we write is an extension of our emotions and our experiences and our beliefs. And it becomes so strange when someone else then takes that and reads it or sings it. And so this song is always confusing to me because I'm attributing all of this with Johnny Cash. And then I have to remember, this is actually from the heart of Bono. Like, Bono wrote these lyrics. So I don't know, just a little philosophical tangent there, but it always throws me off when I have to realize that the person singing the song is not necessarily endorsing or even believing what the lyricist put on paper.
So I don't know if it's this album or another album. There's a song called Wake Up Dead Man. I forget which album that's on. I want to mention a couple other songs by U2 because that line there just kind of reminds me of just some other stuff. We don't need to look up those, but I'm going to read the lyrics off of another song. So the song Wake Up Dead Man, even though it's got, you know, an explicit lyric in it, man, that's a good song. I don't really want to cover it just because there's a line in there. But listen to this song called Grace off of the All That You Can't Leave Behind album. This song has really just gotten to me many, many times when I think about grace. And that last line that we listened to, you know, I think of grace, the grace of God, okay, for forgiveness, the mercy of God for forgiveness. And I think this is a very interesting song. And we're not going to examine this song, but maybe we could ask the question, is grace being taken too far? Okay. Bono has come out and said, you know what, Paul's really good, but he got homosexuality wrong. Right. Don't hold that against Paul. He's defending Paul for coming out against, you know, sin. So anyway, let me read these lyrics to the song Grace. I love this song. It's an amazing song. It says, Grace, she takes the blame. She covers the shame, removes the stain. It could be her name. Grace, it's the name for a girl. It's also a thought that changed the world. And when she walks on the street, you can hear the strings. Grace finds goodness in everything. Grace, she's got the walk, not on a ramp or on chalk. She's got the time to talk. She travels outside of karma. I love that line. Grace travels outside of karma. That's giving, if you could see my arms, you could see goosebumps all over my arms right now. That line has brought tears to my eyes before because, and you guys can go check out the song yourself. knowing what we have in salvation, grace, karma. Okay. And Bono is showing that he understands what karma is. Okay. Trying to do as much good in this life so we get a better next life. Right. And grace travels outside of karma. It's a, that's an amazing poetic, you know, very sound doctrinally line there. Let me see if there's anything else there. When she goes to work, you can hear the strings. Grace finds beauty in everything. Grace, she carries the world on her hips. No champagne flute for her lips. No twirls or skips between her fingertips. She carries a pearl in perfect condition. So what is what once was hurt, what once was friction, what left a mark no longer stings, because grace makes beauty out of ugly things. I think that's an amazing song that describes grace. And it's kind of an interesting there because he's using, it's, it kind of goes back and forth where he talks about grace as a woman, but grace also, you know, as this gift, you know, and it kind of reminds me of Proverbs a little bit, where Proverbs refers to wisdom as a woman. Okay. But I'm not trying to put anything on that song that's not there anyway.
Hey, Tom, I think that's really cool that you brought that particular lyric. I think that that fits perfectly with the little bridge that we just listened to, because I think in thinking in terms of our salvation as the milk and the meat, like the New Testament says that when we're first saved, you know, we're on the formula, we're on the thin baby formula. And then as we mature in Christ and we become older and our bones and our teeth develop, then we can tear into the really deep, gristly, fatty stuff and digest it. And the little bridge vignette there where it basically really fits with its concept of grace. And that is, I'm going to step as close to the fire. And this isn't Bono. He's talking about the preacher in Ecclesiastes. This is going back to Solomon. I'm going to taste every pleasure imaginable. I'm even going to taste madness. I'm going to explore insanity. I mean, if you read Ecclesiastes, that's what he's saying. And if you go into the context of Ecclesiastes, this wasn't just some rich guy who ate a bunch of rich food. He was out there experimenting sexually. He had this massive harem. There are inferences in people who study the ancient texts that he was probably delving into some same-sex stuff and occult stuff and ritual magic. So here is Solomon saying, I'm going to taste everything. And the fact is that that really is a milk definition of grace. When we first come to Christ, we have this overwhelming joy in the fact that he's going to wipe away every stupid, foolish thing that we did before we had eyes to see. But if you're 10 years into your journey with Christ, or you're 15, 20, 30 years, if your concept of grace is still, I'm going to be out there living like I'm a Babylonian, and he's going to just be like, I love you so much. At that point, the meat, the hard, the tough stuff, the stuff that you really got to chew before you swallow it, grace becomes, because of my affections for Christ, his grace is now going to empower me to hate my sin. And I'm going to attempt to pursue holiness. So the grace is what undergirds our pursuit of holiness, not our excitement that we can still party and get that little permission slip sent off to heaven. So I'm really glad that you brought that grace lyric into it, because in that bridge, we are seeing a concept of Solomon's, and then vicariously through Bono's writing of it, this concept of grace, which is really an abuse of what it really is.
Yeah, grace abused, I think, is accurate. Again, I feel like when you're looking at it from the point of view, grace travels outside of karma. It just makes me feel good. It's a reminder of like, yeah, we got one up on everybody else. We're not better. You know what I'm saying? We don't think we're better, but we have a better answer. You know, we have the best answer, the only answer, which is salvation. And this really is the trick. I don't like calling it the trick, but the key to Christianity and what a lot of people can't get. You know, all religions, the difference what sets Christianity apart from all of the religions is all of the religions, you have to work to get your salvation. And in Christianity, that's just not true. It's by faith alone, grace alone, and the work that was done. And it's confusing even to us Christians. We try to work it. You know what I'm saying? But our work should be in response to what's been done, not because we're trying to, you know, pay on something that's already been paid off. So, Kenny?
Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting. I really like the grace analogy. Is a fantastic. I'm going to go look at that song because I don't think I've heard it before. So very cool. When we were talking about this song here, when it says the I went out there and search, experience, taste, and touch, and to feel as much as a man can before he repents. You know, you ever hear people will talk about this stuff and they'll say, well, what's stopping me from just enjoying my entire life? And on my deathbed, I'll just repent for it all and I'll be saved. And I'll say, ultimately, the problem with that is you don't know when you're going to die. And my feeling on is once you have been saved and you understand it, those things for the world, they kind of leave. They don't have the same temptation as they did. It's still there, but you're also people. I see that all the time. People be like, well, what can I? I'll just, you know, I'll do what I want. At the end, I'll just repent when I'm on my deathbed. But look, man, you don't know when you're going to die. You could die tomorrow. You could die right now. So my opinion on that has always been you want to make sure you know where you're at with it, because you don't know when you're going to die. You don't know if tomorrow is still, you don't know if you have that. So to me, when I hear people, because I kind of see that when I'm reading that, he's like, you know what? I'm going to go out here and do all these things and I'm going to experience it all. And then I'm going to repent. But some people don't get the chance to repent.
Amen. Amen. Let's finish this out. I think we got maybe one more.
Cool. So
here we go.
I went out searching, looking for one good man, a spirit who would not bend or break, who would sit at his father's right hand. I went out walking with the Bible and the gun. The word of God lay heavy on my heart. I was sure I was.
So, guys, we've given you our take on this. We want to know what you think. Please leave a comment and tell us, you know, maybe you like Johnny Cash, maybe you hate YouTube. I don't know. We'll be curious to hear what you guys think and what you think about everything that we're saying. So, yeah, I do like those final lines, you know, and I think a lot of us can identify. I went out with a Bible and a gun. Okay. Those are definitely the times that we're living in, you know, spiritual protection and physical protection. Okay. So there's a lot that's that could be said. We're low on time here, but I want to give you guys a chance to jump in and just share.
Yeah. I think the first part of that last part, what jumped out to me, he went out searching. I'm thinking about the verse that says the eyes of the Lord rove to and fro throughout the earth, seeking if anyone is fully committed to him. And that really plays paradoxically really nice with the bridge that we just came out of. I'm going to do everything that I want. I'm going to feed the flesh. I'm going to worship self. At the very end, to save my own skin, I'll repent, which again is just more worship of the self. It's self-protection. But then in the next verse, it says, really, the eyes of the Lord are roving to and fro, not to seek people who have repented in the last moment. He's looking to see who was fully committed to me, who really is on my side. And that is a huge difference. Being fully committed to the Lord is a different thing than feeding the flesh your whole life and at the last minute saying, well, I don't want to burn in hell because I don't want my flesh getting it. Again, it's just love of self. And he's not looking for love of self. He's looking for people who are fully committed to him.
Go ahead, Ken.
Yeah, no, what Vicky said, that's exactly what I was getting from that too. That's fantastic. Yeah. It's interesting when he even says, I was sure I was the one. But the song doesn't come off like that. He says that, but at that point, I'm still thinking you know, he's even saying right after, I don't know if we got to the next part when he says, "Now Jesus, don't you wait up. I'll be home soon." And it, there's an interesting thing with that. You're like, oh man, but I don't know. I still am deep diving in this song. I got into it, but it's, there's so much more to it than I've gotten so far. So,
you know, this song predates the American recordings that were done with Rick Rubin, which were, people think, his best work. Okay. The last six albums. And then all of the, stuff that was later released, but you know, maybe something like this was an inspiration for this, where Rick Rubin saw, wow, this guy's open-minded. Maybe he would come on, you know, my record label and do this stuff. And that part of Johnny Cash's story is just as interesting, where he got kicked off of his own record label. The dude was a living legend and got rejected by his own people in his own town. And here comes this heavy metal hip hop producer. And he says, hey, I want you to do whatever you want. And made some of the best music of his whole life, really.
It's, you know, it's interesting too to also hear, you see interviews with Trent Reznor from Nine Inch Nails, who basically says, he says, I wrote Hurt, but that's Johnny Cash's song.
He took it,
and he knows he wrote that, but when Johnny sang it, it was his song, and he did that to every song he did, man. It was like, even when you hear with this one here, man, you know Bono wrote this, but it just feels Johnny Cash. So, well, it's a good testament for both writers.
That, and that would have been a good one for us to talk about. Even though Trent Reznor wrote it, Johnny Cash sang it. He made it his own, and then you can't really separate the song from the video. I remember when that came out, that had a lot of people messed up. I saw people that were tough guys, and they would talk about that song, and they'd be like, yeah, I got choked up watching that video. So, we got one more. We got one more part to the song. Let's check it out real quick, guys.
Now, Jesus, don't you wait up. Jesus, I'll be home soon. Yeah, I went out for the papers. Told her I'd be back by noon. Yeah, I left with nothing but the thought you'd be there too, looking for.
So, you know, this, the whole concept of this song is very interesting. And at the end of the song, he tells the beginning of the story. He's like, I left saying that I was going to go look, you know, I was going to go pick up a paper, but it sounds like this is a journey of a lifetime, you know, like this guy's gone for years and he's searching, he's looking, and he never came back home. And obviously this is all maybe parallel metaphor, you know, the guy checked out, you know, he's traveling through life, but he's giving this, you know, illustration of, he, you know, went on an actual journey. You know, the Australians call it a walkabout. Okay. So, and I'm sorry for attempting to do a, to do an accent. That was pretty,
and another strip on the Bobby.
That was pretty mean. Folks, we have very precious people from the great place, the great country down under, Australia. So I don't want them to think that all Americans talk like that when we think about Australia. So yeah, we love that country, but anyway, sometimes that slips out. That was like a Freudian slip. Vic, any comments about the last line?
Well, it's kind of like the classic, you know, the guy who decides to abandon his wife and kids. I'm going to go out to the store. And then, like, kids will tell stories about, my dad went out one night and he never saw him again. And so I think it's interesting that that is sort of the metaphor for what we're doing to God. We start out really with good intentions. We were raised in church as kids, most of us, at least in our generation. And we have every intention of carrying that forward and replicating in our own homes someday as adults what we were raised in. And then at some point, for some of us, we get tired, we get wooed or seduced away. And we maybe legitimately really do think we're going to the store just to get the paper. And then we can get lost. We can, when we flirt with these things in our mind, and then all of a sudden one day we're just off course. And so, you know, we've been talking a lot about intentional sinning and, hey, I'm going to just party it up. But what I like about this line is it is sort of incorporating the concept that sometimes we go out with one intention in mind and we lose our way, whether that's from our own heart or an enemy hath done this. But again, it's kind of going back to this grace theme that sometimes it's not this rebellious intention, like I'm going to walk away from God, I can't take this anymore. Right. Sometimes it's just one baby step at a time that leads us a light year off.
No, that's a good point, Vic.
Yeah.
And the movie that I saw last week about Johnny Cash, they said that he would go missing. Like one time he was on his way home and he never came home. He was supposed to, he was gone for 4 days and he went out on a drug binge. Of course, one time he went to Mexico to buy some drugs and he got arrested at the border. Anybody else probably would have rotted in jail, but they let him out. So anyway, Kenny, final words on this song.
Yeah, I think the last word when he goes into the I left with nothing but the thought you'd be there too, looking for you, and it ends with I kept wandering, and so you know at the end of this thing it's not a set in stone. It is, you know, sometimes it's that journey of life that, you know, sometimes you don't get that set thing. I mean, I feel very blessed personally that I know where I stand in my salvation. And a lot of these songs we're talking about are written from the perspective of people who haven't found that yet.
Yeah.
They haven't quite, they're still looking and they're close, but it just ain't quite, it's there. There's still that speculation. And I feel very blessed to not have that kind of thought where my thoughts aren't completely in tune with everything else. So it's a good song. Good choice, Vicky.
Kenny, I think we need a mashup of The Wanderer and I Still Haven't Found What I'm Looking For. Can't you hear the I Still Haven't Found What I'm Looking For chorus?
Oh, you can put it in there.
Bleeding into the song.
Yeah.
It could be done.
You know, and it's interesting the similarities between these two songs. So, folks, we want to hear from you. What do you think about this song? What do you think about Johnny Cash and U2 and all of this stuff? Do you think we're crazy? Let us know in the comments. And we'll be interested to read it. Yeah. But hey, folks, yes, it's true. We're taking a little break. Don't forget about Pastor Sean's going to be back tomorrow night with the Skinwalker Show, Walkers of Skin. Check that out. We're going to be back in January with more Audiotopsy, more shows, more Kenny C, more Vicky Joy. And hey, my name's Tom. Don't forget that tickets are on sale for the Out of the Darkness conference. We're all three going to be there. Greg Reed's going to be there. Okay. Ooh. Pastor Mike Spaulding and Coach Dave Dobemeyer, some other friends are going to be there. Sherry Clausen. It's going to be an amazing time. Of course, Colleen James. You can go over there and pick up a ticket. Reserve your hotel. It's going to be here before you know it. We want to see you, and we want to just fellowship with you, do ministry with you. Check that out, guys. Hey, until then, we will see you in January. Don't forget Pastor Sean tomorrow night. God bless you guys. Bye.